Right, so these are the few questions that I've already discussed, and these are their answers. These are questions from set X, right? Now, this question was question number 4 in set X, and I was looking for the answer. Yeah, so the answer is option number A, and this they have picked up from a research paper that was published in this journal, Inorganic Chemistry. It is a journal by American Chemical Society, ACS. It was published in 2006. This is the reference. So I am 100% sure the answer is option number A. They have clearly mentioned that in the presence of one equivalent of NO, right? This kind of complex where we have three SPH groups and one NO group, it gives this as the product. So basically we have one equivalent of NO replacing one SPH group, okay? And everything else remains the same. And minus charge. So this was option number A. And one, since there is only one equivalent of NO, in rest of the options you will see that more than one NO has been attached to the iron complex. So I mean, if even if you go by just if you go by intuition also, you will understand that if it is not mentioned how many equivalents, it is generally if it is mentioned excess or two equivalents or three equivalents, then you have to consider it, and you have to see what all possibilities are there. But if they are not mentioning anything related to the equivalence, you have to assume it to be one, right? You cannot by yourself assume that you are taking excess of NO. So this is the reference of the research paper, and they have given that for synthesizing such kind of intermediates, this is the starting material, and we add one equivalent of NO, right? So this is the correct answer, option number A for fourth question. Now, let me show you one more question. This was again an interesting question. You should know basic maths for this. And this was question number 7. Okay, it is a mathematical question. You have to find the volume of a parallel. I cannot even pronounce it. It's a parallel epipipe, whatever, e-pipe, parallel e-pipe, whatever it is. It is basically, it is a structure, or it is a shape, 3D shape, where all the faces are in the form of a parallelogram. So like a square, in a rectangle or in a square, for example, all the faces are in the form, in a cube, right? In a cube, all the faces are square. If you are drawing a cube, that is a 3D structure, all the faces of a cube are squares. Similarly, in this parallel epipe, the faces are parallelograms, right? And we have been given three vectors. We have been given vector A, B and C. So you did not have to do anything. You just have to draw the determinant I, J, K, okay? And then you just draw the value. So A is given as 1i plus 2j. So 1i plus 2j, and k is not mentioned, so k you can take 0. Then B is given as only 4k. So 4k means k is 4, these two coordinates are 0. And then we have C as 2i plus 4j. So 2i plus 4j. So again k coordinate is 0. So if you solve this determinant, you will get the volume. Now if you solve this determinant, this comes out to be minus 16. 1 into minus 16. Minus 2 into, I think you know the way of solving a determinant, right? You just have to cancel this row, right? Cancel this row and cancel this row. Then, I don't think I need to, you can just see it anywhere on the internet how to solve a determinant. So, minus 2 into, if you cancel this out, this becomes 0 minus 8. So, minus 8 plus K is 0 itself, so this comes out to be 0 because you're multiplying by 0. If we take this, cancel this out, you're multiplying by 0. So whatever value you get, it does not matter, you'll get a 0 over here. So if you solve this, minus 16 plus 16, so this comes out to be 0. So the answer was 0 cubic units, right? Now there's a shortcut way to solve this. See, I told you it's a 3D structure, right? So a volume is a volume will only be present in a 3D structure. A 2D structure does not have any volume, right? If you see the A coordinates that was given to us, it was 1i plus 2j, and B was given as 4k, okay, and C was given as 2i plus 4j. See, even I have actually studied this. I study all the shapes before going for exam. I mean the volumes and the squares and the cube roots, whatever, like triangle, the various concentric triangles, concentric circles, everything I study, all the shapes, how to find out the formulas, how to find out the formula when the perimeter of a triangle is given, all these things I keep practicing. So that, for me, it was not a problem. But I did not use this formula, even though I knew this formula, the determinant formula. It was very simple. As soon as you see this, A is 1i plus 2j and C is 2i plus 4j. That means, so it is like a line, right? It has two coordinates. So it is like a line. Now, if you take, let's say, I equal to 1 and j equal to 1. If you draw x and y axis, if you take I equal to 1 and I equal to 1 and j equal to 1. So this becomes 2x plus 4y, right? It becomes 2x plus 4y. How do I explain? Just let me frame it well. Actually, if you find out the coordinates, it will look something like this: 1, 2. Okay, then 2, 4. And then for this also, the coordinates will be 2, 4, because you multiply I by 2, I if you take I 2 and J 2, this becomes 2, 4. If you take I 1, J 1, this becomes 2, 4. It's difficult for me to explain, so you can just go with this. What I meant was that if you draw the line for this, if you draw the vector for 2i plus 4j, it will be something like this, okay? It will follow this trajectory. And if you draw the vector for this A line also, the vector will look like this only. It will follow the same trajectory. So that means that we would not have a 3D structure, because two vectors are following the same trajectory, right? And the third vector is along the Z axis, that is coming out of the plane. So it is like a two-dimensional structure. There is no three dimensions there, because because these two vectors are nothing but the same. If you multiply this by 2, you will get the same vector. So this is what I meant, okay? I was not able to explain it to you properly, because I haven't explained maths concepts to anyone for a long time. So it just comes naturally to you. If you have been practicing maths a lot, it comes naturally to you, right? So the answer was 0 cubic units. So the option number, so for 7th question, option number D, that is 0 cubic units, was the correct answer. Then the 9th question was very interesting, and I love this question. Pretty simple, turned out to be a pretty simple question, but at that point of time when you're giving the exam, it took me time also to understand, right? So I marked the right one, but I marked the right answer, but obviously on the answer key I didn't mark it. I do not want to take anybody's seat, so don't worry about that. I didn't mark the right answers. So suppose you are carrying out an experiment measuring the Raman spectrum of nitrogen gas in the outdoor air. Where would you find the higher strength of the anti-Stokes line? So the question says that you are carrying out an experiment, or you are doing Raman spectroscopy of nitrogen gas, and where will you find the higher intensity of anti-Stokes line? So the intensity of Stokes lines depends on the number of molecules in the ground state for Stokes line. The intensity matters with the number of molecules in the ground state. Whereas for anti-Stokes line, the number of molecules in the excited state determine the intensity for anti-Stokes. For Stokes, the ground state, and for anti-Stokes, the excited state molecules. So the greater the population in ground state, higher will be the intensity for Stokes lines, and the greater the population in excited state, higher will be the intensity of anti-Stokes line. That is why when you are doing it at room temperature, generally all the molecules are, in, majority of the molecules are in the ground state. That is why you get very intense Stokes lines and very light anti-Stokes lines. So the question says that where would you find the highest strength of anti-Stokes line? So basically you have to think at in what kind of conditions will molecules be occupying a higher energy level. Okay. And the options were in Kanyakumari, on top of Mount Everest, the strength will be same in both the places, or nitrogen does not have an anti-Stokes line. So option number D is totally incorrect. Now if you see, at Mount Everest the temperatures range on an average, even in summers, the at the top of the Mount Everest, the temperatures are around minus 40 degrees Celsius, and in winters it can go up to minus 90 degrees Celsius. Right? So sometimes general knowledge also helps you a lot, because I like to do mountaineering and all. I in fact went to the base camp of Mount Everest, like it is at somewhere around 18,000 feet, the base camp. So I went up to the base camp. And so I have this knowledge that at Mount Everest, the temperatures can, I mean the warmest temperature can go up to minus 40. Like in summers, temperatures are around minus 40 degrees Celsius. And in winter, it can go up to minus 90 and so, right? Right. So this is the general range. So different, and in Kanyakumari, you can take the average temperature to be 30 degrees Celsius, right? So definitely when the temperature is high, like 30 degrees Celsius, more number of atoms will be in the excited state. Whereas at these temperatures, such low temperatures, minus 40 to minus 90, there would not be enough energy provided to the molecules, and the molecules, the majority or the higher population of the molecules will reside in the ground state. So this will have majority in ground state. Okay, no doubt at 30 degree also the majority will still be in the ground state, but comparative to this, to the top of Mount Everest, the molecules in the excited state would be much more in this case, that is in Kanyakumari, because it is near to the equator. So generally the temperatures are really high throughout the year, right? So that is why this is around 30 degrees Celsius. This will have higher population, comparatively higher population in the excited state, and that is why in Kanyakumari you will see a higher intensity anti-Stokes shift taking place. So the correct answer is option number A. So I have discussed question number 9. Answer is option number A. Then we have discussed question number 4, which again had option number A as the correct answer. And we had discussed question number 7, which has correct answer as option number D. One more question I would like to discuss is this question. Which of the following is not correct with regard to the uncertainty principle? Okay, this is the second question. Which of the following is not correct with regard to the uncertainty principle? So the option number D, measurement of one variable in an atomic system can affect subsequent measures of certain other variables. That is absolutely true. So this is not the correct answer. It is saying which of the following is not correct with regard to the uncertainty principle. So, uncertainty principle states something and something opposite is happening. So you have to identify that. Okay. Right. So the question means that the uncertainty principle is stating something, and you have to find something which the uncertainty principle does not state. Okay. It does not state. So measurement of one variable in an atomic system can affect subsequent measurements of certain other variables. This is true. This is predicted by the uncertainty principle, that if you try and find the position exactly of an electron, then you cannot find the momentum, and if you try and find out the momentum, you cannot find the position. So both cannot be determined simultaneously. So this is correct. So this is not the correct answer. The second, other option is a harmonic oscillator possesses a zero point energy. So this is also in accordance with uncertainty principle. Okay, I cannot explain right now because it is quite a lengthy derivation, but the uncertainty principle correctly defines the zero point energy of harmonic oscillator. So this is absolutely correct. This is in accordance with uncertainty principle. So this is also the correct option. Then we have an electron in an atom cannot be defined by a well-defined orbit. That is absolutely true. Again, due to the uncertainty principle, for convenience sake, we show the orbit like this. But if you actually see the orbit, it is somewhere like it is like this, okay, because of wave nature of electrons. I mean, it is like a density, like that's why orbitals also, you cannot define the orbitals exactly. You show the orbitals like this and the electron can be anywhere in this, the probability of finding the electron could be anywhere in this region. Okay, there is some cutoff. It's generally around 90-95%. I mean, the probability of finding the electron in this particular region is equal to 90-95%. There is some cutoff. I don't exactly remember the value. It is around 95%. Okay, that the probability of the finding the electron is in this region. Okay, so again, you cannot pinpoint that the electron is present over here. You give a region where the electron can be present. So similarly, you cannot define the orbit of the electron. There is a rough sketch of where the electron could exist. Okay, because of the wave nature of electrons. Basically, this is the whole idea of quantum mechanics, right? You cannot exactly predict the position and the momentum at the same time. So again, because of this, you cannot state the position, or you cannot have a well-defined orbit. You can have an orbit, but not a well-defined orbit for an electron. That is also in accordance with uncertainty principle. So option number A is also not correct. So the correct answer is the momentum of an electron cannot be measured exactly. Now this is not in accordance with uncertainty principle. There is a catch in the line. The momentum of an electron cannot be measured exactly. The momentum of an electron and position cannot be measured exactly simultaneously. You cannot measure the momentum and position of an electron simultaneously. Okay, it is simultaneously. There is a big difference between measuring simultaneously and measuring alone. So alone you can measure, because if you are not measuring the position, you are just measuring the momentum, then you can find the exact momentum. But if you are trying to determine the momentum and the position at the same time, then you would not be able to find it according to the uncertainty principle. So uncertainty principle does not say that the momentum of an electron cannot be measured exactly. The momentum of an electron can be measured exactly, but not simultaneously with position. So the correct answer according to me is option number B. Here I have some doubt, because I don't know what their thinking is, whoever said the paper, but according to me, if I go logically, it has to be option number B. Okay, so I discussed four questions. According to me, these question number 4 I am sure, question number 9 also I am quite sure, and 7th also I am sure. So with 2nd I have some problem. So I think not some problem, I am quite sure, but again, I'm not 100% confident with this. So but according to me, it should be option number B, right? So again, next day, maybe I'm keeping a little busy. So if possible on Wednesday, or if I get some time on Tuesday, I'll solve one or two couple of questions, right? And till then, try your best. And if you have some doubts, please feel free to comment below. If you think that the answer could be something else with a logical explanation, please comment down below. I'm open to debate. I would like to know what your opinion is, right? Thank you.